Welcome to Learntivity. In this video, we are going to calculate the PI for different types of amino acids and for peptides as well. Let's start with the alanine as an example for amino acids, with only one group of both alpha carboxyl and amino groups. Alanine has two pK values, pK1 for the alpha carboxyl group and pK2 for the alpha amino group. In biological system, at pH around 7, the carboxylic group will be deprotonated and has a negative charge, while the amino group protonated and has a positive charge. This structure with zero net charge, called the Zwitter ion. The isoelectric point, PI, is the pH at which the amino acid has no net charge and is electrically neutral at the presence of Zwitter ion, and then can be calculated for alanine as the average of the two pK values. Let's have a look at the relation between pK values and the charge of the amino acid, and understand how to calculate the PI value. Let's draw the pH line and place the pK values on it. At low pH, below pK1, all carboxylic and amino groups are protonated. The net charge for alanine is +1. As the pH increases, at pK1, the carboxylic group will lose its proton, and the net charge becomes 0. And at pK2, the amino group will lose its proton, and the net charge become -1. As we see, the charge normally decreases by 1 at every dissociation step. As we see, the Zwitter ion, with no net charge, is the one in the middle. Then we use the pK values, before and after the Zwitter ion, to calculate the PI value. What if we have another carboxyl group on the side chain? Let's now take a look at the aspartic acid. It has three pK values. The pKr, here, is for the side chain functional group. And we can tell, from the low value, that it is for a carboxylic acid group. Let's put the pK values on the pH line. At pH below pK1, where all groups are protonated, the net charge is +1. At pK1, the alpha carboxyl group will lose its proton, and the net charge change to 0. At pKr value, the side chain carboxyl group lose its proton, and the net charge now is -1. And at pH value equal to pK2, the amino group will lose its proton, leaving the net charge at -2. As we see, the Zwitter ion is between the pK1 and pKr, the pK values for the two carboxylic groups. Therefore, the PI value will be calculated using only the pK1 and pKr values. Then, for acidic amino acids, the PI value is calculated based on the pK values for the two carboxylic groups. But what about the basic amino acids with two amino groups? Let's see the basic amino acid, lysine, which has one extra amino group on the side chain. Below the pK1 value for the carboxyl group, the net charge is +2. And when carboxyl group loses its proton at pK1, the net charge decreased to +1. The second dissociation is at pK2 for the alpha amino group, where the net charge becomes 0. And at pH equal to pKr, the side chain amino group loses its proton, and the net charge becomes -1. The Zwitter ion here, between the pK values for the amino groups, the pK2 and pKr. This is also the case for the basic amino acids with two amino groups. The PI value is then calculated using the pK values for the amino groups, pK2 and pKr. What about calculating PI value for a peptide? Let's take this tetrapeptide as an example. Each amino acid has pK1 and pK2, so which two pK values do we need to use? In a peptide, we know that the free group on the left side is an amino group, while on the right side it is a carboxyl group. In peptides, the amino acids are connected with covalent peptide bonds. In this example, there are no amino or carboxylic groups on the side chains. Therefore, the internal amino acids won't affect the charge, nor the pi value. For that, we just ignore them and their pK values. Then, only free groups will affect the peptide charge and the pi value. For glycine, only pKa value for the amino group, pK2 will be used for pi calculation. And for serine, only pKa value for carboxyl group, pK1 will be used. Only, these two values will be used to determine the peptide charge at different pH values, so we deal with a peptide as a single amino acid that has a pK2, similar to that for the amino acid at the left side, and a pK1, similar to that at the right side. In summary, the charges of an amino acid, or a peptide, change by changing the pH. For an acidic amino acid, the charges change from plus 1 at low pH to minus 2 at high pH. While for a basic amino acid, the charges change from plus 2 to minus 1. This should give us a hint. At very low pH, we expect the basic amino acids to be more attracted to the negative electrode, while at high pH the acidic amino acids will be more attracted to the positive electrode. Alright everyone, thank you for watching. We hope you've learned some valuable information. Make sure you like, comment, subscribe, and turn on the notification bell. We'll see you soon, but until then, keep learning and stay creative.